cùng nhau ạ.
Dreaming of owning a property in a prime location with great proximity and fantastic neighborhood? EJ Investments Sanyang Seaview Estate is the best choice you have been waiting for. Our Sanyang Seaview Estate is approximately 15 minutes drive away from the busy hub of Busubi roundabout and into the heart of nature, where you can have a peaceful and relaxed lifestyle with your family. You can buy a finished 4-bedroom story with 5-year flexible payment plan or a service plot with 2-year payment plan option. With over 300 homes, you'll enjoy big tar roads with covered drainage, modern electrification with solar street lights, gated entrance with security post, and a breath-catching experience of our beautiful sea view and lake view. You can own a home today at our Sanyang Sea View Estate. Call us today on 446-4838 or 325-9220. Visit our website on ejinvestments.net. EJ Investments, first in property.
All right.
Honey, did you remind him that the last time he sent the money, it was not enough to buy all the provisions?
Oh, sorry, I forgot to tell him.
Are you guys talking about money transfer to buy provisions?
Yes.
But
don't you know about Baluwo?
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 What is Baluwo?
Baluwo is a service that your son can use to send provisions directly to you guys from the shop. And you don't have to worry about the exchange rate.
Tell me how Baluwo works.
It's very simple.
Just log on to baluwo.com and shop, or download the app on your phone. You can shop on the website or using the app to buy online basic products for your family and friends. With Baluwo, you decide what your money is spent on. Your money, your choice. Buy online products for your family and friends in the Gambia, Senegal, Nigeria, or Mali. Baluwo, better than sending money.
Stewart & Co. Solicitors, a legal excellence firm in London that can help you with all aspects of your legal work. If you are looking at immigrating to the United Kingdom, Stewart & Co. can help you to set up business, buy houses in the UK, and will deal with all your legal works from start to finish.
For all your general immigration work, we can help you with that as well. If you apply for any form of visa, whether student visas, settlement visas, marriage visas, or a child wanting to come to the United Kingdom to settle with the family, we can help you to achieve your goals.
Stewart & Co. Solicitors, a legal excellence firm specializing in conveyancing, immigration, litigation, family law, personal injury, licensing, no win, no fee. Contact us today at www.sk-solicitors.com.
Nga type baluwo.com, downloadal app bi nga jëfëndiko ko ci num gëna gaawé.
$100,000 ci la
gëna. La ilaha illallah.
Tay yow xam nga ni sama papa dafa amé cardiaque.
Yow da nga dof.
yow xam nga luy won $100,000
am na ko kay man na lu ñu bëggoon nga dimbali
demal na nga def dama tok rek sama xel mi na ci yow am nga barki dem li dal ci ben way fe
waaw
ma romb ko rek barki dem
waaw
muy yuux
yuux
di tepp mané ki lu ko dal ñu ni ma dal ci loto gaming gambi bi la laal
jar nako
laal na ci lu di waaw
nga dafa am quarté am kenté am tiercé waaw manam nak tay ji kenté bi la té jackpot bé passé
xalis kenté moy lan
kenté manam moy juroomi fassi
waaw benen bi
amna quarté
moy
ñenti fassi ak tiercé
ñaa
tay nak xalis bi da gëna yok
lutax
jackpot beulé dañ ka tégaat ci bi manam juroomi fassi boko jappé ci ordre moy risque nga désordre bi sax day fay
yoy mom non la demé da ngay dem rek jé
amna luma yaaka
gis na sien ki qu'est-ce que yu ndaw yi ci biir dëkk bi
mais
dal dama ni li mom amul xaaliss tan ci def sa xaaliss da
am jël wéccé rek sanni ko fa xol jëmbat la
ah
la ilaha illallah yow li nga wax ni tay ji bu yalla dogalon ma gagné ko lu mu gatt
fim tolni bo gagné won $100,000
waaw numay def
waaw noy def
xam yow sama xarit nga
waaw
damay fexé nga ray say non
ci nan
lu mu gatt $50,000
way
Tierno wo wala ambulance
lan lu xew ni
sa bay gay deena
sam papa gay lu ko ray
$50,000 nako boma gagnalon ci lima la yondi dama ko koy jox mu daanu ni sama kaw
man waxumako mu waxe won lako non yow la ko waron informer ndax yow ya ko gagné ya gagné jappone
na broda mi mbay europe ni sta konté nga bo wala kolkan say na suko na mano banta jabo banta tulo ban say nga bo wala kolkan da ka bo ci solo kana ba dama bulo mutari mbaka ta fintilano ni ko mbatu ngani ta ya priye ma koy dumanti na ta mano sa ni tulo ni jaw
munda be tan la broda mam balo service kala
mun service
balo service
ni da foronte mo kala
munda afi la broda ko abita la internet hol aya ba site la woldo balo.com nay wo sadje a apo ñu ba download la telephone lo na be sandiro to ni wal na be sirin ala office ko ndama manjar pour ay tabang ko ko doki a be sirin office ko da min to e do message so yo telephone ko no e biti ko be gambia dawda biti ko ba bele ko ta tano dawda yeta fen ko taw
wodama
yara
bar wo service na ta molda ata ñu le be kan fi jalla bro dan ka ko
ata ñu lo ko
ayo ko ti da
balwo service din kirala jampo o manken na kolaya ko balwo service sal de mano ka je ko ale do morfe ngol sang ala dimba ya molu ana lakanun tewul wato bela ani wad sudum panan kono balwo service la din kiralu ani la do ku nyolu e be banko karo bedo kabirin carton fo koyna nalla fe ko ku koton sur balwo service la koldo ali commandi telephone la no la milbuko 94002137694319 wala 3192870 wala hankabi alta internet do alila ko lu jibe www.baluwo.com
wanwa tsama cheese pa filani yeah wa sami ka sadam dandira ne ma di cheese pon femina ya me se brand villa ne ma di cheese pa pichilina godina go ina ya o bandina Say my G chills for Trevina Yeah, me say Gandila Say my G chills for Trevina Go in a, yeah Wanna have a cool place to need you Gandila are the place to be you Cool view, come chill and relax Have fun, enjoyment to the max 752-7218 Take a phone call to Gandila, yeah Special treatment for the idea Right place to be, so I'm telling you, yeah It's not the right place to be Come on, fun and enjoy the life Cool place to be Yeah
For more information, just log on to www.granvillaguesthouse.com
diwli lanni maro lanni
fop lanni
awa jodi mi anda honno gerde ten e galdo sabu e galdo ibrahima jonnal taw joni mi anda se yahay kapiti ki nyawlo den ha hum pondire makko esko non e warude
wadeno
ane gore
Ibrahima ma ko to woni
mo America
ah ko America woni hein kare ngum pita ki fi be musibe me baluwo
baluwo
hein ambe andan da kala ko wada wonde aduno si arrivi e juude mabbe a jonnay do departement Gambia har no wet aya ata kadi taw ko mbudi din no jawi walla no jippi be halantama ko kala ko falda ko reese sengo nyamete il n'est pas maro basal bomdete kala ko rewi dom a hendo to harno wedi kadi wona dum non tu be abbe jondira mobile phone siko dum kadi laptop kala ko wayro de dibe ay kasba wa be wawma jonnute kadi sa wala on pitade ko wedi etu Google account ma joni data ton wada download app mabbe on ayay kala ko humpi ma e mabbe ton be webi ama
ka wonta woy aduna on
kala ko wawda
a jonnana e wondo kaleedi men Gambia do depense
harano webi ama si dun no fono nebi immo den joni mi do tama ka place mabbe jan
wada en joni
iya heba ko fala
wada en kisan
And my proceedings.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, Commissioners. Good afternoon to you all. We are indeed ready, and the witness is in the waiting room.
Thank you.
I, Lamine Diouf,
do swear
that
I will speak the truth.
I will speak the truth.
The whole truth.
The whole truth.
And nothing but the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Good afternoon, Mr. Diouf. Welcome to the commission.
Good afternoon. Thank you.
We met this morning. My name is Harija Balagay, and I will be questioning you today on behalf of the commissioners. As I informed you already, today your testimony will begin the events of April 10 and 11, 2000. And so your presence here is to assist the Commission, particularly with contextual information about what occurred. Do you understand that?
Yes, I do.
So a few housekeeping matters before we continue. Please try to speak slowly. There is interpretation into the local languages. Additionally, please allow a few seconds at the end of my testimony, my statement, before you start giving your account, and each time I ask you a question, so that there won't be overlapping speech. Do you That's understand
okay.
that?
That's okay.
So for your testimony today, we will cover about 5 topics. I understand that you will not be available tomorrow, and we were supposed to start with your testimony much earlier today. Therefore, today will be a bit of an abridged version of what we would have hoped to hear. And if necessary, then I will seek to admit the rest of your statement into evidence. Is that fine with you, sir?
That's okay.
So the topics that we will address are your biographical details and academic qualifications. We will briefly just look at the structure and organization of the Gambia Students Union between 1999 and 2000, just so we have an understanding of what's to come. Then we will talk about the background, so the events that led to the student demonstrations of April 10 and 11, 2000. And then we will focus on the events of April 10 and 11 itself. And then we will briefly end with impact. So the bulk of your testimony will be about the events that led to the demonstrations, as well as the actual activities that occurred on the day of the demonstration. Do you
That's
understand?
Okay.
So for the record, can you please state your full name?
I am Lamine Diop.
And Mr. Diop, are you known by any other name?
Yes, a household name, Diop Keba, Lamine Keba.
Can you tell us your date and place of birth?
11th of November 1970, Biam.
And very briefly, your educational background, where you went to primary, secondary, and higher education.
Briefly, I attended Iliasa Primary School between 1980 to 81, and then moved on to Brikama Kabafita Primary School, 81 to 88, where I sat to the common entrance exams, and then had admission at Brikama Secondary Technical School from 1988 to 1992, where I sat to the secondary fourth school leaving certificate examination in May-June 1992, and then proceed to Nasir Ahmadiyya Muslim High School, where I completed my high school education and graduated with few credits, and then in 1998, I was enrolled at the Gambia College School of Education to pursue the Higher Teacher Certificate Program from 1998 to 2000. And then after completion, I was posted to Jarume Koto Basic Cycle School as an acting vice principal for 2 years, and then in 2002, I became the acting principal for 2 years as well. That is from 2002 to 2004. And then in September 2004, I was posted to Sololo Basic Cycle School. I started the school as a basic cycle school as an acting principal. And then I spent one academic year. From there, I came down to the University of the Gambia to pursue my first degree in education, where I did education, and my teaching subject was economics. And then after that, I was posted back when I completed in 2007. I was posted to Bansang Senior Secondary School, where I served as the vice principal up to 2014. And then 2014, I came down to the mainstream admin with the Ministry of Basic and Secondary Education. And then in 2015, I had a master's a scholarship to pursue my MSc program in statistics with the University of Gastonbury. And I had my MSc degree in statistics just last June 2018.
That's a very good summary. Can you just tell us currently where you work and what position
I work with the Ministry of Basic and Secondary Education.
What position do
you have? As an admin officer.
Please allow a few seconds in between our speeches.
Okay, all
it's
right.
It's easy to forget.
Okay.
Thank you for that. So in 2000, I want to take your mind back to the year 2000, which is what we're focused on. Were you a member of any student union in the Gambia?
I was. I was a member of the Gambia College Students Sub-Union as the information minister from June 1999 up to June 2000. And the Gambia College Students Sub-Union has two components of students' union, because then at the time, Brikama campus and Banjul campus existed. Brikama campus housed the School of Education and that of School of Agriculture, while the Banjul campus housed the School of Nursing and School of Public Health. And so the need for a sub-union to take care of or to take charge of the affairs of students within the Brikama campus was necessary, and then there was a student sub-union which I belong to. Nonetheless, you have the main union where the four schools or the four components of the Gambia College are part of the main union. And all these two unions are affiliated bodies to Gambia Students Union called GAMSU.
So your role as information minister was within the sub-union, is that correct?
Exactly, but we equally work in partnership with the main union as well as GAMSU as well.
So in 1999 to 2000, what was your role as information minister? What were your responsibilities?
Basically, is to make sure that the student body within the Brikama campus are better informed about the daily happenings of what is happening within the college. And equally, we are responsible for the production of a newsletter of the student sub-union. We equally organize a symposia, debates, quiz, literally exercises within the students in the Brikama campus.
So from what you've explained, it sounds as though the union was organized like some sort of administrative body, essentially, with ministers. Can we talk about the actual executive setup of GAMSU or the sub-union, as well as the leadership?
Yes, the sub-union, like I said, because many of the students fall within the School of Education. And so you realize that most of the school students are part of the School of Education, and it has the largest population. And I could also equally remember 2000 was equally the same year when Gambia College, for the first time, registered a large or admitted a large number of students, because our badge HTC was only 75 students. But the 900 plus started with the 2000 badge. So we have a larger body of students to take care of. And so that is that component of it.
So tell us a bit about how it was set up. Tell us about the executive members as well as the leadership.
Yes, the executive comprises of the president, which at the time was Aliou Kan. The sub-union president was Aliou Kan.
Was there a vice president?
The vice president was, at the time, Maurice Jerome Gomez.
What about the main union? Who was the president during that period, 1999 to 2000?
The main union president was Kebasar at the time. And Saja Kamara was the information minister who I work hand in hand with.
But who was the vice president of the main union at the time?
The vice president, I could not recall that now. But I know Kebasar was the president then.
And in terms of your membership, you told us that you had a large body of students. Is that correct?
Yes.
Do you recall roughly how many people fell under the sub-union, which is where you were part of?
This over 1,000 plus.
Over 1,000 individuals?
Yes, over 8,000.
And was the main union registered? Meaning
they are all registered. All these two unions are registered, including GAMSU.
Just allow a few seconds between
right,
our speeches.
Okay.
And when you say they were registered, who were they registered with?
Attorney General Chambers.
So they were recognized as the body responsible for the welfare of the students generally?
Yes.
What else fell within the mandate of the students' union?
To promote unity among students, because at that time Gambia College as one of the highest institutions of learning, we really felt that to take charge of students, we obviously need to show examples. We need to show examples, and that was why the union, like I said, those portfolios were created. And just like you were asking, they are almost similar to a running government. So that obviously clearly shows how responsible and how organized the structure of the whole organization is. Likewise, the same thing has been extended to the main union.
Were there mechanisms in place within the union to deal with, for instance, conflict or dispute resolution?
Yes, of course. We have an advisory committee that is responsible for that.
So if, for instance, there was a matter concerning a student, what kind of mechanisms does the union have in order to deal with that? Do you have investigative powers, for instance?
Yeah, of course we do. The union, at the level of the sub-union, we do, and then wherein we did our own part, we have to hand it down to the advisory committee to equally take its due process of the whole thing.
Can you tell us a bit about the relationship between the union and the sub-union with the authorities, for example? Were you considered independent at that time?
We are, of course, very independent. We are really very independent.
So in 1999 to 2000, what was the relationship like with the authorities?
It was cordial, because I would say we were the first group of people outside Kanilai who deemed it fitting. We went to the president's garden at the time in 1999 just to give a helping hand, because then we saw the need, the efforts the government is trying to put into education. We felt there is that need, and we went as a group of students from the Gambia College, we went to Kanilai to help him on the gardens.
So from what you're saying, you voluntarily took it upon yourself to go to the garden of the president to work?
Yes.
And for you, that's an example of the type of relationship that you had with the authorities at the time?
That is one of them.
What about the security forces? What was the relationship around 1999 to 2000, prior to the demonstrations?
Normal, very normal and cordial.
So let's talk about what happened in 2000, which then led to the actual demonstrations. Did you receive any information in your position as Minister of Information of the sub-union concerning a matter involving students and security forces?
Precisely, if I will say the death of Ibrahim Obarim on the 9th March, which occurred on the 9th of March on Thursday 2000. I was in class, and then I had a group of students, they called my attention, and they asked if I know what was happening in Brikama. Then I inquired, and they said a student was killed by fire officials. Then I...
Sorry, when you say by fire officials, you mean officials of the fire service.
Exactly.
Please continue.
Then I tried to look for Aliu and few other executives, members of the sub-union.
And by Aliu, you're referring to Aliu Khan?
Yes, the sub-union president.
Yes.
And then we convene an emergency meeting. In that meeting, we discuss on the issue of the dead surrounding Ibrahim Obari's death. Because one narration said it that, or has it that, he was given cement to eat. So there were so many, 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 many things coming out. So we do not know which one is which. So we said then we have to go down to the school and find out, because equally, if what was reported is true, then there is a disciplinary problem. And also at the level of the school, there is a problem there administratively.
So I just want to focus on the meeting that was called. Was it held on the same day that you received the information, meaning yes, 9th of March?
Yes, this meeting was held, emergency meeting was held the same day.
You mentioned Aliu Khan. Can you tell us who else was present at that meeting apart from you?
Almost all the executive members of the sub-union, some main union executive members were also there, and Gamsu representatives or Gamsu executive members who were part of the college then were also there, because Alhaji Esdabo is one of them, or was one of them.
And Alhaji Esdabo's role at that time was?
He was the vice president Gamsu.
Of Gamsu.
Yes.
So at that meeting, it was to discuss the information you received about Ibrahim Obari.
Yes.
Can you tell us what decisions were made at that meeting?
In the meeting, we came to a conclusion that we need to go down to the school to do our investigation. But before the investigation, we need to equally address the general student body at the school, because we saw a disciplinary problem emerging. And this was what we agreed upon. And then the following Monday, because this was on a Thursday, the following Monday, which happens to be on the 13th of March, then we left the college. A 5-man delegation was set up, including myself, Alhaji Esdabo, the Vice President Gamsu, Sajar Kamara, Information Minister, Main Union, Boubacar Cisse, part of sub-union, and Molo Balde Gamsu. We left the college.
What was Molo Balde's role at that time?
I couldn't remember that now. I knew at that time he was part of the executive of Gamsu.
So to make sure I understand, this team of 5 people were responsible for conducting some kind of inquiry into what happened to Mr. Ibrahim Obari.
Exactly.
Right? Who was the leader of this group?
I led the team.
And that was in your capacity as
Information Minister, exactly.
Please tell us what happened on the Monday when you went to... Where did you go?
On that Monday, we left college around between 12 and 1, because we understood the school at Foster's operates on an afternoon shift.
Why did you go to Foster's? What's the connection between Foster's and Mr. Barry?
That was where the incident happened. That was where the problem happened.
So Mr. Ibrahim Obari was a student at Foster's?
Was a student at Foster's Senior Secondary School. But these two grade 10 classes were housed under Brikama Technical Training Center. So they were housed at Brikama Technical Training Center, known as the old site, while the 11 grade 11 class and the 12 classes are at the new site.
So at that time, Mr. Ibrahima Barry was a student in grade 10, is that correct?
Exactly.
Okay. Please continue.
So we left college around 12 and 1, between 12 and 1. We decided that our first port of call is going to be Brikama Police Station. We went to Brikama Police Station. We registered our concern as to the information we received regarding the death of a student at Foster's school, and they in turn gave us a CID officer. But what I could not remember is whether we went along at that same spot with the CID officer to the school or the CID officer joined us later at the school. That is what I could not say for certain. But we obviously were assigned a CID officer. And the CID officer along brought three witness statement forms, which we took along.
So prior, I just want to understand, prior to assigning a CID officer to your team to help you with the investigations you were conducting, do you know if the police had already began conducting their own investigations when you went there?
I don't know.
Did they say anything to the effect that they had already started their own investigations?
I couldn't remember that.
So from what you know, you informed them of what you were doing. They seemed willing to assist by giving a CID officer to assist you.
Exactly.
Please continue.
So we went down to Foster's school. We went to the senior master's office, who was at the time called Mr. Ajao. He was the one responsible for the school. We introduced ourselves, and we told him about our coming to the school, which was, of course, very much welcomed by him. And we told him the need for us to even start to address the students, if that is equally possible, at an assembly, which he consented to. And then we were given that forum, the students were gathered, and then we spoke to the students at length on matters of discipline, on matters of respecting their teachers, because their teachers are their everything. So it is obviously very much important and key for students to realize this. This was one of the things we obviously discussed with them. And then from there, then we had an interview. The senior teacher responsible for the school, Mr. Ajao, was interviewed. The class teacher of Ibrahima Barry, Ms. Kamara, at the time was also interviewed. Ibrahima Barry's friend, whom he was sitting with that same or that fateful day, was also interviewed by the name Alhaji Gianna.
Was it only those three individuals that you interviewed?
The father, Ibrahima Barry's father, by the name Ali Obari, was also interviewed, because from the school we went to the house of Ibrahim Obari, and then we met the father.
So let's focus on the interviews that were conducted at the school.
Yes.
Who did you interview first, do you recall?
Mr. Ajao, of course, the senior teacher.
Can you tell us what he, what information he provided you with?
He said Ibrahim had a problem with the commerce teacher by the name Mr. Paul. And so Ibrahim fought with Mr. Paul. And after the fight, Ibrahima went home, was asked to go home. And when he went home, the following day, he came back to school. According to him, he said, then when he realized Ibrahima was in school and was in class, went to the fire service at Brikama to report the matter to one of the fire service officials, to only come with him to go to the school and escort Ibrahima out of the classroom and be handed down the suspension letter.
Did Mr. Ajawa explain to you why he went to the fire service regarding an internal disciplinary matter at the school?
I believe because he was a foreigner, he must have some trouble sometimes in dealing with some of those situations, I believe.
When you say he was a foreigner, where was he from?
We made to understand he was a Fritonian.
So he, first of all, at that point, did you know where the fire service was located? Because I'm trying to understand why he went to the fire station.
Very close. It was very close to the school, only about 150, 200 meters away or 300 meters away from the school, if I'm not wrong.
And from what he explained, the reason why he went to get a member of the fire service was so this individual could witness the suspension of Mr. Barry.
Exactly.
That's what he told you.
Exactly. That's exactly what he told me.
What else did he tell you?
So he said that was what happened. And then when he appeared with the fire officer, they called Ibrahima out. Ibrahima came out. And then they went to the office. He was handed down the suspension letter. And then he went off with the fire service officer.
Based on your experience as someone who was part of the students' union, had you ever had a situation like this where the school contacts the fire service in order to deal with a disciplinary matter?
It is an anomaly. It is not normal.
So you were equally surprised by that?
Exactly.
Okay. What happened? Did he provide any other information, or did you get the rest of the information from the
Yes, he did. He did provide information, because that was not the end with him. Then when Ibrahima went away with the fire service officer, he said shortly after when they left, they returned with the father. The fire service officer, Ibrahima, and Ibrahima's father. Which equally corroborates with that of what Alhaji Gianna, the friend, told us.
And we'll get to Alhaji Gianna.
Okay, all right.
Please continue with Mr. Ajao.
Okay. So when they appeared, the father pleaded with Mr. Ajao that he never knew that Ibrahima had a problem the previous day at school, because Ibrahima didn't tell him anything. So Ajao, the father, went along, I think, with somebody accompanied him, an old man. They succeeded in convincing Mr. Ajao, because according to Ajao, when they went through the records of Ibrahima, obviously they found out that he was not obviously that unruly student as one might thought. So he succeeded, the father succeeded in pleading with Mr. Ajao, and then he accepted, and then was asked to come back after Tobaske, because then it was very close to Tobaske.
So Mr. Ajao accepted the apology made by Ibrahima's father on his behalf, and then said Ibrahima could return to school after Tobaske. Is that correct?
Exactly.
Please continue. What else happened?
So this was what he said, and that was the last time when he saw Ibrahima, until the next day, on the 9th, on the 9th, when they had the news of the death of Ibrahima.
What was Mr. Ajao's reaction to what happened to Mr. Barry Ibrahima?
Very regretful, very regretful.
Is that to say he did not expect this to be the result of getting the fire service involved in a disciplinary matter?
Of course, because by the end of his story, he burst into tears.
After your interview with Mr. Ajao, who did you interview next?
The class teacher, Ms. Camara.
Can you tell us what Ms. Camara told you?
Corroborated almost the same story, and equally added that Ibrahima was indeed an average student. He do participate very well in the class, but most of the time too, he will not say anything. He will rather left to be alone, concluded the sobbing and tearful class teacher as well.
Did she also provide any information as to Ibrahima's general behavior in class?
That was what I said. She said Ibrahima was an average student, very hardworking, and take part in the class discussions. But sometimes he will not. He will just be alone. He will not say anything.
But she didn't highlight any kind of disciplinary issue.
She did not.
So let's talk about your interview with Ibrahima's friend. I believe he provided you with a lot more detail about what happened.
Exactly.
Mr. Alhaji
Gianna.
Gianna.
Yes.
Please tell us about that.
Alhaji
Are you okay, Mr. Job?
Yes.
Should I give you a few seconds?
It's okay.
There's some water on the table as well. Please no, feel free.
It's okay.
Okay.
He said they were sitting at the back of the classroom when Mr. Paul, the time for commerce lessons, entered the classroom and asked them to relocate from where they were sitting at the back of the classroom to come in front. When they came in front, they sat where the sun has its rays. And then, according to Alhaji, Mr. Paul asked him to relocate, but left Ibrahima where he was. So Ibrahima complained that because the sun has its rays there, so it's going to be impossible for him to sit there because it is obviously affecting his eyesight. And then he insisted that he will not sit there. And then he got up from where he was, trying to move to another seat where it is clear. So it was during the course of this, a heated debate ensued between Ibrahima and the class teacher, and the commerce teacher, Mr. Paul. And then, according to Alhaji, all of a sudden, then Mr. Paul scolded Ibrahima. And then Ibrahima couldn't stand it, and then gave him a hard punch on the face. And then a fight broke out. So they were separated, and then Ibrahima was asked to go home and went home. So the following day, when he...
Do you recall on which date this occurred, this event that you're talking about, the fight between
this the was on the 7th of March.
7th of March.
On a Tuesday.
So after...
That was the day Ibrahima had a problem with the commerce teacher, Mr. Paul. It was the following day, on the 8th of March, on a Wednesday, when Ibrahima came back to school.
What did Alhaji tell you about what happened when Ibrahima came back to school on the 8th?
Yes, according to Alhaji, when he came back to school the following day, Wednesday, they were in class when Ajao appeared with a fire service officer, and they called Ibrahima out. So that was the last time Alhaji said he saw Ibrahima for the school session. Then he didn't see him for the rest of the day, and he went home. And then he was there too in the evening. He said, let him go and see what is happening with Ibrahima. He went to the house.
Before that, did Alhaji provide you with any information about who the fire service officer was? For example, did he recognize the serviceman?
No, he did not.
Okay. So what happened that evening when Alhaji went to visit Mr. Ibrahima Barry?
So Alhaji went to Ibrahima's house in the late evening, found Ibrahima was in pain, Ibrahima was crying, his voice was not even very clear to hear, and he started asking him what went wrong. And Ibrahima started telling him that he was beaten mercilessly, and he was poured on, water was poured on him repeatedly, and his hair was even forcefully shaved off.
Who did all of those things to him?
The fire officials.
That's what he told Alhaji.
Exactly, the fire officials. When we come back to the father's story, that will also confirm that. So he said he spent much of the time with Ibrahima. And Ibrahima was all along telling him that he's going to die. And he started telling him that, no, you are not going to die. Things will be okay. You will not die, you will surely live. So he said he was there up till it was a little bit late, and then he departed. He left Alaji, only to realize the following day that Ibrahima was pronounced dead.
The fire station that Alaji referred to, was it where was it located? Was it also in Brikama or somewhere else?
The
fire station.
Yeah, it's in Brikama.
So it's the Brikama fire station.
It's just a walking distance from the school where Ibrahima attended.
And so from the information that Alaji gave you and the other investigators, essentially, conducting the inquiry, he said it's the fire service officials who beat Ibrahima Barry mercilessly.
Exactly.
Poured water on him.
Exactly.
And forcefully shaved his head.
Exactly.
So when Ibrahima came home that day, he was in a lot of pain.
Exactly.
That's the information you received from Alaji.
Exactly.
What else did he tell you about Ibrahima?
Yeah, he also said after when he was released from the fire station, he went to Brikama Health Center. And according to the nurse told him, they can't treat him until when he comes, when he report the matter to Brikama Police Station, and which he did. Because when I asked him, he confirmed that. Ibrahima said he went to report the matter to Brikama Police Station and then came back to the health center before he went home that same evening.
So after your interview with all these three individuals at the school, at the Foster school, you said you then went to Ibrahima Barry's house and interviewed his father.
Exactly.
Is that correct?
Exactly.
And the father also provided you with information. Please tell us what information he provided.
Exactly. We reached the house almost close to nightfall, around Maghrib.
Still on the 10th of March, right?
Yeah, exactly. On the 9th. Sorry, on the 13th. It is on the 13th of March, on Monday.
Okay, 13th of March. Please continue. Thanks for that clarification.
Yes. We found the father by the name Ali Ubari. We introduced ourselves and we told him why we were at the house, because we are equally students at the Gambia College. And we are concerned, and we equally heard about the news of the demise of his son. And so we went to the school to find out from exactly what had happened at the school level. And then there we are to equally find out from him, ask the father to know exactly what had happened, so that we know exactly what to report back to the general students' body. He welcomed it, he welcomed us, and then he started his story. The old man swore sternly before he started telling us anything that he was a Muslim, and he is only going to tell us what he knew about the death of his son. Not on the account that because his son is dead, he will try to say anything that he didn't know about, and continued him, or continued Mr. Ali Ubari. He said he knew about the problem on the 8th of March, 2000, on a Wednesday, when Ibrahima was suspended. And he appeared before him at the market, because he was selling at Brikama Market, which is not also very far from the school. Ibrahima went with the fire officer at the market, found him there. And then the fire officer told him about the incident that had happened at the school, that Ibrahima is an unruly child because he fought with the teacher. And so Ibrahima needs to be disciplined. And then the father said, but I wasn't aware of all this because Ibrahima didn't tell me that he had a problem at school the day before. So can you help me? We go back to the school so that I can talk to the master or the school authorities, which he equally succeeded in doing. Then that was the time they returned to the school with an old man, like I told you, who accompanied them to the school to meet Mr. Ajao, the CDO master, responsible for the school at the time. So when they arrived, Mr. Barry told us he succeeded in pleading with Mr. Ajao. Like I said, they didn't find any previous indisciplinary issues surrounding Ibrahima, so it was easier for Ajao to accept to forgive Ibrahima. And then from there, they were going, the fire officer told him again, reminded him that they are going to take Ibrahima along to the fire station where he will be safe off because he is not disciplined. So according to him, he thought they were only trying to make him scared. When they go there, they perhaps will not do anything to him. That was his belief.
Ibrahima's father.
Yeah, exactly. That was the time he returned to the market. Only to realize that in the late evening, when Ibrahima came back, was called upon to see Ibrahima's condition, was in pain, seriously, and he told us, Ibrahima said the same thing. He was beaten mercilessly, water was poured on him repeatedly, and his hair was also saved forcefully.
And did Ibrahima tell him who did that to him?
The fire officers.
That's what his father said.
Exactly.
Please continue.
So he said they managed that night, but Ibrahima's condition was not improving. Instead, it was deteriorating. They managed with that until early morning on the 9th of March, on Thursday. He left the house early for the market. According to him, he first left early morning, so he went to the market. But just arriving at the market, he was called back again to say Ibrahima's condition has now worsened. He has to go back. On his way going back to the house, according to Ali Obare, he met with them on their way back to the health center in a vehicle, and they stopped. He joined them. And according to him, the time he went into the car, he found Ibrahima dead. But as the head of the family, he didn't disclose it. He could not disclose it at that time. He has to swallow that bitter pill at that moment. And then he continued with them to the health center. Upon arrival, tests were performed on him and later pronounced dead. So this was exactly what he said.
Did he provide you with any information as to the cause of Ibrahima's death? Was he told anything by the doctors, or did he just come to his own conclusions?
Whether Ali Obare was...
The cause of Ibrahima's death. Did Ali Obare, the father,
at the health center?
Yes.
I'm not sure. He didn't tell us anything about that. He didn't say anything about that. He only said before they even arrived at the health center, Ibrahima was obviously dead. He knew that. And when they reached at the health center, when doctors or nurses performed tests on him, also pronounced him dead.
And from what you have said, the information you gathered was he was at the fire station until later that day. He came home. He informed at least his father and his friend, Alaji, that it was the fire servicemen that beat him, that poured water on him repeatedly and shaved his head. And that when he was at home, he was in pain. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Did they tell you anything about his condition as far as they could tell? just from looking at him? Did they observe anything in particular about his condition?
The family of Ibrahima.
Either the father or his friend, Alhaji.
Can you repeat that again?
I want to know if whether when they looked at Ibrahima, they could observe any anything in terms of his condition that evening.
Of course, because being in pain alone is something observable. It's something that you can see. Struggling, and according to Alhaji, like I said, Ibrahima's voice was not even clear. It was even difficult for him to hear what he was trying to tell him. So all those things speak volumes of exactly what had happened.
Did they mention anything about injuries?
No, they didn't mention anything of physical injury
that
they could see.
Mm. But obviously, from all accounts, they could tell that he was in a difficult situation.
Sure.
I know that Alhaji did not provide you with any name of the fire service man that came to the school. What about the father? Was he able to provide you with a name?
No.
Okay. And in the course of your investigations, were you able to find out the names of any of the fire service men
involved? Yeah.
How did you come to find that information?
Foreign newspaper, because I equally have been reporting to foreign newspaper. So, and again, at the Gambia College, we are always been given copies of all these newspapers, Daily Observer, Independent, Foreign. The information minister is always giving all these copies, almost every publication.
So what did they publish about the names of the individuals involved in Mr.
The seven fire officials being alleged, the names are there in one of the newspapers I had.
Well, we will follow up on that. Thank you for that information. So having gathered all that information about what happened to Mr. Ibrahima Bari, what did the student union do after that?
We report back to the college executive and to the general studentry through the notice board, because at the college at the time, the notice board was our everything. All communications to the students comes through the notice board. So that happened, and equally the executive were briefed about our findings, which we put it to them. And a meeting was convened, I think, on the 20th of March, because then there was a break between that 13 to on the 20th, the Tobaski came in, and then there was a break.
Before we talk about the meeting of the 20th March, what was the mood like amongst the students as a result of what happened to Mr. Ibrahima Bari?
It was really frustrating. You could imagine what was going on in almost everybody's mind if we've gone that far in this country, school matters getting into the hands of wrong people, and at the end of the day, only to receive that. We could only imagine what that kind of situation is going to lead us to. So people were worried all over. We are all worried, because we are all asking the same question, who next? Nobody knows. It could be me, it could be the other guy. So that was why, in solidarity and in unison, as a responsible student body, we went down to the level of the school, to the house of Ibrahima, to gather all this information so that we will not at any point in time misinform the students' body, so that they will know exactly what had happened.
In fact, one of the rumors you mentioned earlier was that you received information that Ibrahima Bari was given cement to eat. Based on your investigations, did that turn out to be true?
The father obviously dispelled that, and nor did Alhaji also talk about that, nor either the senior master or the class teacher. We didn't found that story to be correct. But however, somebody somewhere in the independent newspaper concluded that Ibrahim was caught stealing, which is very, 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 very wrong, which is not true.
So you're saying that one of the reports was that by the independent newspaper?
Exactly.
Was that Ibrahim was caught stealing?
Exactly.
And that's something, at least based on what you've said, that's not correct.
Very, 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 very wrong.
It was a disciplinary issue between him and a teacher that led to the involvement of the fire service.
Exactly.
Thank you for that clarification. Can you tell us what happened on the meeting of the 20th March 2000?
I briefed the student executive about our findings, and we came to a conclusion that we should go on a peaceful demonstration so that a wake-up call will be sent to the authorities. Because up to that time, there hasn't been any arrest that has been effected in connection to the death of Ibrahim Obare, we made to understand. So when they were briefed, this is exactly, we told them exactly our findings surrounding his death, and then so the need to march to the commissioner's office at the time. Then that was Keba Sise. And equally, the charity that we collected at the college level will also be given to the family house from the commissioner's office. Then we would have paid our condolence to the family. That was exactly what was discussed in that meeting on the 28th of March.
So the purpose of staging the demonstration was because the student union felt that no action had been taken by the authorities. Is that correct?
Exactly.
And the march was to end at the commissioner, is that in Brikama?
Yes, the march is to start at the gate of the college to the commissioner's office, from there to Ibrahim's house, where we will give the family house, the charity, and then back to the college.
What happened after that? Did you proceed with the demonstration?
We did. On Wednesday, on the 22nd of March, we did. We gathered the students. The students were reliably informed of what we should do.
Prior to that, did you inform any of the authorities that you were about to stage a demonstration?
I am not aware. We do not.
Was there any particular reason why you decided not to do so?
Yeah, because we only wanted to go to the commissioner to show the commissioner about our frustrations and equally to pay condolence to the bereaved family.
So no sort of permit or information was provided informing the authorities that you were about to stage a demonstration?
No, we didn't do that.
Okay. So what happened on the 22nd?
So early morning on Wednesday, on the 22nd of March, we gathered at the gate of the college. I could remember the then PEO at Region 2, Mr. Kaka Isanyan, coming out from the regional office, finding out as to why we are gathered there and what we are about to do. And we told him exactly what we wanted to do. And he started pleading with us that we should not go ahead with the demonstration. Rather, we should take time and then listen to them and see what is going to happen. And we said, no, we are not going to do that. We're going to go ahead with our planned demonstration. We said it's going to be a peaceful demonstration. We are not going out to do any other thing. We only want to go to the commissioner, the head of the division, to know exactly what had happened and equally know about our frustrations and equally to pay condolence to the bereaved family. We didn't see much big deal with that. So he called the principal, the then principal, Jenu Mane, and the then registrar of Gambia College, S. Mane, and they all joined him out. They found us at the college gate. We told them the same thing. So we went ahead. We walked, the student leaders were in front, we hold each other's hand, one another's hand in front, the executive members and the rest of the students' body followed.
Were you carrying any kind of signs or placards, for instance?
Yes, we do. We are carrying placards, writings. Who killed Ibrahim Abari? Justice delayed is justice denied. Who raped Binta Bari? Sorry,
Bintamane?
Bintamane, exactly.
So at that time, you had already received information that Bintamane was raped.
Exactly. We also had information which Gamsu was also working on.
Can you tell us what you know about the incident related to Bintamane? What exactly did you hear?
According to they came on an athletic competition at the Independence Stadium. I think it was during the course of that she was raped, according to, by some unknown paramilitary officers. That was what was alleged. So that's exactly what was also happening, and the issue was obviously with Gamsu. They were also on it, trying to investigate it to find out exactly who did that. So, and all of a sudden, this other incident also happened at Brikama, so we tend to put the two together.
You said that it was during some kind of sports at the stadium, which would have meant that Bintamane was a student at that time. Is
exactly.
That so just to make sure we understand, Gamsu, the main union, was investigating the issue related to Bintamane, the alleged rape by paramilitary officers, from what you've said. And then your sub-union was focused on the death of Mr. Ibrahim Abari, which was at the hands of the fire station, allegedly.
Exactly.
Okay. Please continue with the demonstration.
So we walked down to the commissioner's office. But it was not easy because we the crowd we were going with, at some point we were not comfortable, simply because people are too much. And then we tried to go through the other way.
Sorry, just a second. You said because at some point the crowd was, you were uncomfortable about the crowd. People were too many.
Yes.
Were these other students joining in, or were they individuals from around the neighborhood? Could you tell?
I would probably say yes. Someone Lucas, obviously, particularly when we were returning from the house at the market end, we could no longer control the students. We could no longer control the crowd. The number just get, it was just increasing.
Well, let's focus on your journey from the Gambia College as you were going. You said at some point the crowd grew bigger and you felt, is it uncomfortable? Is that the word you used?
Yes, yes.
Was it because of the size of the crowd, or was there something else to it?
Yeah, exactly, because of the size of the crowd. So we went to the commissioner's office. I believe before we even arrived, we found they were already ready because he must have received news of our coming, because Kakai Sanyang himself, police officers, the commander commanding, I think, Brikama Division, Brikama police station officer, Brikama police station, were all there. We found them, and the chief of Kombo Central.
You mentioned Kakai Sanyang. Who is that? Was he a
member? He was the principal education officer at the time responsible for Region 2.
So all these authorities were aware that your group was coming, and so you found them at the commissioner's office in Brikama.
Exactly.
Tell us what happened there.
We even met the group outside the commissioner's office to receive us. And Aliu, our president, main union president, delivered a short speech regarding the death of Ibrahim Abari and our investigation into the death of Ibrahim Abari. And up to that time, we didn't hear any news of apprehending those people responsible. So we were really very much worried, and we are very much concerned, and we felt that was the time for us to visit him, to tell him about our frustrations, for him to know exactly about that.
What was the reaction of the authorities that you met in relation to your concerns?
It was really okay. It was really cordial because they really assured us that justice will be done and they will make sure that it is, they speed it up to make sure that what we are complaining about are obviously taken care of. That assurance was obviously given.
So did you have the impression at that point that steps were being taken to investigate it?
Following the assurances? I would say I had the impression that steps would be taken.
So they were promising that they would actually do something about it, not that they had already started doing it.
Exactly.
That was your understanding.
Exactly.
Of it. What else happened during that meeting?
That was the short meeting, and then we left for the disease house.
Did they try to stop the demonstrations in any way?
No, they don't. They don't. They don't. They don't.
So at that point, with police officers and everyone present, you registered your concerns, they responded in order to assure you, and then you proceeded to Mr. Ibrahim Abari's house. Is that correct?
Exactly.
Please tell us what happened when you arrived there.
So at the house, we found the family. We introduced ourselves and we told them about why we are there. Speaker after speaker, but it was so emotional. You could now see the emotional outburst. We could no longer control people. People are now seriously crying and wailing. Onlookers tend to join to be part of the crowd. Now the crowd is even bigger, almost three times bigger than the crowd we came along from the college. So we begin to really be very much equally scared about the consequences, because we knew, obviously, we're going back to the college, and we are to pass via the fire service, then we knew, obviously, it's going to be problematic.
So up until Mr. Ibrahim Abari's house, the demonstration had been peaceful. It grew in size. But at the house, that's where emotions started running high. And then you started to get really concerned about what could happen on the journey back. Did you take any steps at that point based on that realization that things could get out of hand?
Yeah, before we even departed the house, we started addressing the students again. We said, yes, we knew obviously this is really going to be the outcome of coming to the house. We cannot obviously stop that emotional outburst, but we obviously are pleading to make sure that that is, to make sure that we observe our ultimate objective, and that is a peaceful demonstration, so that the authorities will realize what had happened and why are we out in the street. So we should not go against that. We obviously warned them.
What was the reaction of the crowd in general to those warnings?
Like I said, it's like at that point in time, almost everybody is in tears. So it's like you assume that things will go fine. But in our minds, obviously, we know obviously it's going to be problematic. That we know that.
So you felt it would, things would be problematic, but at the same time, you felt that people had been given warnings and perhaps things would be fine.
Yes.
Tell us what happened after that.
So we came up to almost where the now Brikama Community Radio Station is. We wanted to take the other road leading to avoid the fire station at all, but we could not. It's only a few who followed us, and then the rest turned the other way around going towards the fire station. So we have to follow them.
So your attempt to avoid any kind of reaction was not only to warn the people present, was to also try to change your route.
Exactly.
But that didn't happen.
Exactly.
So instead, people still took the same route towards the fire station and the Gambia College, and you said you followed them as well.
Exactly.
So at this point, you were not leading, but you were being led. Is that correct?
Exactly. Exactly. That was the turn of events. So there we are, a rain down of stones, like we expected, from students, from those who joined the students, because like I said, the crowd is now three times bigger than the crowd we came along from the college.
So around what area were stones being thrown, and at what, or at who?
Around the gate of the fire service. And in fact, they stormed the whole fire service compound, the premises. They had to run to run for their lives.
So at this point, it's the students attacking the fire station with stones and entering the fire station itself, which led to the servicemen fleeing.
Yes.
At this point, were you able to control anything?
We tried very well. We tried, we pursued them. Until when we saw a Land Rover full of paramilitary officers, about 10, 15 men, they came down, they were just standing looking at them because they can't do anything. They can't do anything. I'm not saying I've never seen that such of a that type of a crowd, but it's one of the biggest crowds I have ever seen. Because, like I said, it's like three times the size of the population we came along with. So we tried until when obviously people thought the windscreens of the fire ambulances were all broken down into pieces, obviously. I think this was what, when they realized that happened, then that was the time students, people started retreating out of the premises, and then we were able to regroup them and then back at the college.
So you told us that at this point, they were three times the size of the group that you left Gambia College with. Can you give us an estimate of how big your demonstration was?
This number could be close to above, well over, around 5,000.
So generally, let's
because
just say
it's
a large.
It's the market area, so automatically it attracts a lot of people.
Students and non-students.
Exactly.
Apart from the fire station and the damage caused, including to the ambulances, did any other property or building suffer damage?
No, it was only the fire station and the fire ambulances, which windscreens were all broken into pieces.
Apart from using stones, was anything else used to damage, to cause damage?
I didn't see anything of that nature.
Apart from the damage to property, was there any injury caused to anyone, as far as you know?
I didn't also see that.
So not to any member of your group, the demonstrators, or to the fire service?
Yeah, not to my knowledge.
So you told us that the group, everyone regrouped, and you continued, presumably, to Gambia College.
Exactly.
Tell us what happened there.
Then at the Gambia College, we found, I can say the college was strong with security officials all over, security heads from all over. We found them, and we were summoned to the principal's office for a meeting. And I could remember Tatin Baji, then the CMC commandant, was there.
CMC, as in Crime Management Unit?
Yes.
Do you recall his full name?
Banding Baji.
Banding Baji, a.k.a. 13 Baji.
Yes.
Which other security...
The Commissioner of Police, West Coast.
Do you recall who that was at the time?
I could not recall that. The Commissioner himself, Kebasise.
Commissioner of Brikama.
Yes.
Yes.
The chief of Combo Central, the Mbosan Tambojang, was also present.
Was anyone else present?
Yeah, some immigration. I think immigration boss or representative from the immigration were there. State House were there. NIA were there.
What about the IGP? Was he present?
I think he was there. I think the IGP was there. The permanent secretary for Department of State for Education at the time, Dr. Jalo, was also there. Said Jalo.
You said, I believe the IGP was present. Are you sure or you're not sure?
I'm not very sure.
Okay. So what happened during that meeting?
In this meeting, they all expressed concern about our actions to demonstrate without a permit and to also demonstrate. As a result, it led to the damage of those fire ambulances. So most of them, that's exactly what they were of concern. Until when we were given the opportunity to air out exactly how we were feeling. And then Tatin Baji then came in and then said, it was really not our fault. We should have been put in the picture regarding the dead or investigations regarding the dead of Ibrahim Abari. And so he, at that time, handed over the post-mortem report to me, which I made a comprehensive report with the investigations we did at the school level with the father of Ibrahim Abari, and it was published on Forea on the 25th edition of Forea newspaper.
So in fact, from what Mr. Landing Baji told you, 13 Baji, it turns out that the police were conducting some kind of investigation. Is that the impression he gave you with
that
the
was,
post-mortem?
Yeah, exactly, that was the impression given, that they were doing some investigations, but we didn't see anything of that,
and
or any serious investigation.
And the post-mortem report that he gave you, you provided a copy this morning, which I have with me. So I will ask that someone gives it to you so that you can confirm whether or not this is the document you gave me. And that would be a post-mortem report concerning the death of Mr. Ibrahim Abari.
That's okay.
Mr. Chairman, I note that we have 5 minutes.
This is the same. It's the same. One copy, one copy. Just give me one and then give her the other copy, if that is possible.
I'll just... So in fact, Mr. Job, I'll just give it to you as it is, and then you can read from it.
Okay.
But I wanted to seek a point with the chairman.
Okay.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, we have about 5 minutes left, and because the witness this morning took much longer than anticipated, Mr. Job is unfortunately not available tomorrow. And so I ask the indulgence of the commissioners for 30 minutes in order to address the rest of his testimony.
Understood. We may continue, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Mr. Job, is that the document that 13 Baji handed over to you?
Yes.
The head of the crime management?
Yes.
Unit. Can you read what it says at the top of that document?
I sometimes battle with my eyesight, so I don't know. It says Health Laboratory Services or Service Royal Victoria Hospital, Banjul, The Gambia, date 10th March 2000, time 11 12 a.m. strictly confidential, on the instructions of the coroner of Brikama, the undersigned on this day carried out a postmortem examination within the mortuary of this institution on the body of Ibrahim Abari, which was identified in my presence by the following persons: Seku Bari, uncle of Brikama Perseverance; Keba Bari, brother of Brikama Perseverance. Present at the identification was First Class 448 Kalilu Jao. I think it's Jao. The writing is fading. My findings are as follows. External examination.
If I could just stop you there, can you tell us who, if you turn the page over, can you tell us who is the author of that report, the post-mortem report?
It's Dr. Rafael Rizzo, the histopathologist.
And this would be at the RV, well...
RVH, yes, at the time.
At the time, RVH.
Yes.
Perhaps we can just skip to the cause of death.
Okay.
And then you will tell me what you understood from the report. So if you can read the portion that says the cause of death.
Yes, cause of death. In fact of the right lung located in the middle lobe and base with severe hemorrhage, necrosis, severe edema of both lungs, acute respiratory insufficiency, hepatic steatosis. Yes, that's the cause of the death.
And what did you understand by that?
From this, it means not a natural cause.
And when you received this report, your understanding of it was that his death was a result of internal complications.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Seems to be a foul play.
And neither of us is a doctor here, so I would just say it's a document that we would admit into the record for follow-up. But this is the copy that you received directly from 13 Badji.
Exactly.
Has the document been in your possession from that time?
Exactly.
March 2000 up until today?
Exactly.
Mr. Chairman, I seek the admission of the post-mortem report. We will, of course, conduct further investigations because we're not sure if this is the only report or if there have been subsequent reports in relation to the post-mortem. So it would be admitted as Exhibit 0071.
Request granted.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So, Mr. Job, from what you've told us, it is the interviews as well as this document that formed the basis of your investigations into Mr. Ibrahim Abari's death. After this meeting where Mr. 13 Badji gave you the post-mortem report, did the union take any other steps in relation to the death of Mr. Bari? The sub-union I'm talking about, your union.
Yes, we do, because like in this meeting, there were concerns being raised about the rest of the institutions in Brikama. Hence, we did that demonstration that Wednesday. So we took it upon ourselves to go back to all the schools in Brikama the following day on the 24th to sensitize and talk to all those schools within Brikama about our actions, and that we do not want to see a repetition of that, because now authorities are equally concerned and they've assured us that they are obviously going to do something about it. So we do not want to see any other plan or any other demonstration. which we did the following day.
So in essence, you were reassuring the students that steps were being taken by the authorities, and exactly. Also condemning the acts of criminal damage that were done by protesters.
Exactly.
What happened after that?
After this, an unusual meeting came about on a Friday, the following day, early morning, when we were at the college. By 7 a.m., the Interior Minister came with the IGP to the college, and we were told we should have a meeting with them that early morning. So we went out worried and surprised as to why that early morning and why so equally very sudden and prompt. So we were called into the computer room at the Gambia College, and the meeting was chaired by Dr. Bojang, the then Dr. Bojang, who was then the vice principal. The meeting lasted for about only half an hour or even less than that. We saw a change in the tone of the voice of the IGP and the Interior Minister, Usman Baji.
Can you give us the full names of the IGP at that time, as Rex well King. As the Interior Minister?
Rex King.
Rex King, the IGP.
And Usman Baji, the Interior Minister. And
I just want to make sure this is correct. In your statement, it says Sankung Baji was the IGP. Is that an error?
That must be an error, yes. He was the deputy IGP.
Okay.
It was Rex King who was the IGP.
So it was Rex King who was present,
exactly.
As well as Interior Minister.
Exactly.
Usman Baji.
Yes.
Okay. So you sense a different tone
in their voices.
Mm-hmm.
And it was this time very hard and harsh that they don't want to see any kind of this again, and if anybody try it, you will see what they're going to do to you.
What and, were they referring to?
Huh?
What were they referring to?
That if anybody go out again on demonstration, you will see what is going to happen to you. So Aliu Khan, the president, started talking to them. But I couldn't stand it. I have to chip in, and I told them, with due respect, I don't think we are afraid of anything. We are not afraid of anything. If there should be anything, that will come our way. We believe we are on a worthy cause, and we must see justice be done. That is why we are here. And uprootedly, the meeting ended.
So 2 days prior, you were reassured from the meeting that you had with the authorities.
Exactly.
Including Landing Baji, 13 Baji.
Exactly.
And then 2 days later, the meeting
exactly.
with the IGP and the Minister of Interior, you sensed a change in tone. What effect did that have on the union and plans to take any further action?
That something not normal is happening, because things are changing, and we do not know why, as to why the sudden change in the whole process. So that was our stance. We made it clear to them. Well, we are on a worthy cause, and we are not obviously going to back out, and we are not going to be afraid of anything. If it should come our way, we will take it, because we've already seen the fate of this young Ibrahim Obari. So we are all putting our place, or we are all putting ourselves in his place. That was obviously our stance.
Was there, did the union hold any subsequent demonstration after the demonstration of 22nd March 2000?
After hours, then there was a break. The following Friday, which was on the 31st of March, college closes for Easter. And we went on Easter break. And then the rest of the meetings continued, but Aliu then was representing the union, because we are on Easter.
That is Aliu Khan.
Aliu Khan. And I then took it upon myself, because I was a HTC student, I supposed to file in my project for the completion of my program. So I took that time to make sure that I start doing something about my project. So I was obviously very busy while Ali was now acting on our behalf with the rest of the other Gamsu officials.
So we only have 25 minutes left. Can you tell us about the subsequent demonstration?
Exactly. Like I said, I was busy with my project. I always work during the night, very late at the night, and I go to sleep by 5 or 6 a.m. in the morning. So this particular day on the 9th April, I went to bed usually at around that time. So I was woke up by my younger brother that somebody is on the line, is calling you. The following day, on the 10th of April, I woke up and then went to receive the telephone call. And it was Saja Kamara, my counterpart, the main union information minister, who was at the end, at the other end of the telephone line, asked me whether if there is any demonstration going on at Bikama at that time. I said, anyway, I'm just coming out of bed. I don't know exactly whether there is any, and I am not even sure. He said, anyway, there is one happening here. People are out, and it's turning violent, so I don't know. I said, okay, then why not let me go back and see? Then that was the time I rushed into my house.
So up until that point, you were not aware of the planning of another demonstration?
I was aware, but I don't know the actual date, okay. Like I said, because then Aliu now is taking it up because we are on holidays, and I was also busy with my project. I was aware that there should be a demonstration if they do not do something, but I don't know exactly when.
If the authorities do not do something.
Exactly.
So when you found out on the 10th of April that a demonstration was indeed taking place, tell us what you did and what you observed.
Then I went to the house, put on my gown, and I pick up my notebook with my student ID card. I rushed to around the police station. And while I was going, all what I'm seeing is thick smoke, heavy smoke in the cloud. People running helter-skelter. People are shouting there is demonstration. So I walked past the police station. I saw the police station being burned down to ashes. Then I found a group of students now meeting, standing face to face with the army officers around the road leading to Brikama Health Center, just opposite Nyaikunda. There is a bakery there. That was where students were standing, facing the security forces. So when I arrived...
Around what time was this?
This was between 11 and 12.
And from what you've said, this was in the area of Brikama. Hmm? The smoke that you saw, it was in Brikama.
It was in Brikama, yes. It was in Brikama.
You said you saw, was it the police station in flames?
Exactly.
Do you know who did that?
I can't say for certain at that time because I was just coming out from my house. So I would not know exactly who did it.
And you said that people were running helter-skelter. What were they running away from, do you know?
Yeah, because of what they saw.
Just the commotion or were they being chased?
Yeah, the commotion at the time, yes.
Continue telling us what you observed.
So when I confronted the student group, most of them recognized me. Like I said, I was meeting with them constantly. Most of them recognized me. So I was there standing with them, talking to them, calming them down, telling them they should disperse because things are getting out of hand and we were facing the soldiers. So all of a sudden I heard the voice, fire. And then all of a sudden a young man standing beside me fell on my feet, struggling for air, blood was coming out. I now understand things have turned terribly worse.
So when you heard fire, what was actually being fired were live bullets?
Gunshots.
Live bullets?
Live bullets.
And the person you said was shot next to you fell down and blood was oozing out of that person?
Exactly.
What happened to him?
I was confused. I don't know exactly what I am to do next. Then the rest of the student body now are running for their lives. And then the chasing started. Soldiers started chasing them. And the firing continues.
So the individual that you said fell down, what happened to him?
I believe he must have been taken to Brikama Health Center. That I couldn't confirm. But equally, along the line, I also understood that an unidentified body, up to the time of burial, I believe it was that young man at Brikama.
So you told us that someone yelled fire and live bullets started being fired. You told us initially that when you got there you saw soldiers. Were there any other security personnel present?
All soldiers. They were all soldiers.
Were there any police officers present?
I didn't see any of the other outfits, security outfit there except soldiers.
And the soldiers that you saw, do you recall what they were carrying?
They were carrying their guns.
Do you happen to know what kind of guns?
I will not be able to know exactly what type of gun they are carrying, but I know they are obviously all armed. So all of a sudden, I had a voice, grab him, he's the informer.
That I just want to make sure this is clear for the record. The people who were firing, which led to the man next to you falling down, who you believe was dead, who were the people who actually fired?
The soldiers.
As far as you could tell, did anyone apart from the soldiers, was anyone else firing apart from the soldiers?
All what I saw are the soldiers. No other body, no other person.
So please continue. What happened next?
So like I said, I had a voice, grab him, he's the informer. So they pounced on me and then they started hitting.
Who did that?
The soldiers. And then their costa was standing by and then all of a sudden they were taking me, they are hitting me seriously with gun butts, with their hands, kicking me. And then all of a sudden I saw Modu Jaju. Then he was a driver. He was the driver to that mini costa. And he knew me because we go with the elder brother. So he asked them to stop. And then that was the time they stopped. Then they took me inside the van.
So you may not know this, but I will ask you the question nonetheless. Do you by any chance know where those soldiers belong to? Where they came from?
They came from Yundum Barracks because they took me to Yundum Barracks and we all went there together.
Apart from the coaster that you mentioned, were there any other vehicles there?
No.
At the time, could you tell who was in charge of the soldiers that were present?
I couldn't.
So from what you've said, the only person you recognize was Modu Jaju,
exactly,
the driver.
Yes.
And the soldiers who were beating you, did they cause any injuries?
No. They don't.
Do you recall how many of them were beating you?
About 4 or 5.
And they were beating you with their gun butts?
Yes.
Did they do anything else to you?
They were kicking as well, slapping.
Do you recall how long that lasted?
Oh, just briefly. It was just brief. And then Modu told them to stop because he knew me. He told them and then they stopped and then they took me into the van.
When you were put in the van, were you the only one in the van or were there
other... I was the first person to be in the van.
Did other individuals join you, other students, for instance?
After my arrest, then the search continues. They were now moving. We started moving with them into the interior of Brikama. They started now picking, arresting people until when the van was fully loaded, and then we were taken to Yundum Barracks.
In terms of the people that they were arresting, were they just picking people off from the streets, or were they looking for specific individuals?
Yeah, they were just picking people from the street and houses. If they suspected you, they just grip you and then put you in the van.
So essentially mass arrests were conducted?
Sure.
Did you recognize any of the students that were arrested with you?
I don't.
Apart from what happened to you, and you mentioned other individuals were arrested, did anything happen to any of those individuals during their arrest, as
yes.
far as you know?
When we were taken to Yundum Barracks, I was specifically taken to a cell, and the rest were taken to a hall. And I was made to understand that those who were taken to the hall, over 100 people, were being beaten from that time until the following day.
They were being beaten by who?
The soldiers.
At Yundum Barracks?
Exactly.
How did you find out about this information?
Because the following day, in the morning, they took us around their premises to pick up that, which we did. And after that, they took me to join the rest of those people at the hall.
So essentially, not only were people arrested and beaten, they were also forced to pick up litter from around the barracks?
Yes.
And then taken back inside. Did you recognize any of the soldiers at this point while you were at Yundum Barracks?
Yes, I recognized another neighbor, which is just a stone throw from my house. But he was an onlooker because the soldiers were inside with those in the hall. And I could still remember this guy who they said came from one of the cells in one of the police stations that was broken into. And he was used as an entertainer at that hall there. He will be asked to dance, and they will be clapping, and if the soldiers, they are not satisfied, they will still hit him. I have seen that with my eyes. And then while this boy was standing, this soldier, Dauda Koli, just a neighbor, was standing. So when he saw me, I saw them talking to one another with the other soldiers he was standing with.
So the person that you said was taken from the cell and made to dance for the soldiers, was that one of the people that was arrested with your batch?
No, he was not taken at the cell. He was at the main hall. I was the only one, those who were brought from Brikama, I was the only one being taken to the cells. I believe because of being a student leader. And then the rest, they were all taken to the main hall.
So he was one of the people who was arrested and taken to the main hall?
Exactly.
And the soldiers forced them to dance for them?
Yes, exactly.
While
exactly.
they clapped?
And if they were not satisfied, they would be hitting him. I have seen that.
And this is something you witnessed personally?
Yeah, exactly.
Within Yundum Barracks, do you remember where you were held? Where were the cells located, do you remember?
I could remember this is a big building behind the mosque. There is a big building there, and it has a bigger parlor, and then it has a corridor inside. In that corridor, there are two rooms there, the other one this way, the other one facing this way. That was where I was, the other one on the right-hand side, that was where I was locked up.
You mentioned that the people who were arrested with you were beaten the day that you were arrested until the next day, from what you heard.
Those who were
in the main
hall, yes, yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Do you recall who told you that information?
When I was taken there, I was sitting with one of the guys. He showed me the back, what happened. I saw the lacerations, yes.
So you were taken to the hall afterwards to join?
Just briefly, I said, after collecting that data, I was taken there. So when I saw this neighbor, like I said, I started seeing them, they were talking to one another, then all of a sudden, then they just took me back to the cells.
Did you notice any other injuries on any of the other people who were arrested?
Apart from the one that I was sitting near, yes.
What kind of injuries did you notice? Similar injuries or different ones?
Yeah, exactly. Similar laceration on the back.
Did any of them tell you anything else about how they were treated? Apart from the beatings that they mentioned?
Yes, like I said, they were malhandled. They were being beaten all throughout.
What else happened while you were at Yundum Barracks?
So I was at Yundum Barracks. That same day we were brought in, soldiers were now shouting, insulting our mothers. They will come and when they saw us in the cells, they will start shouting, Oga is not here. If he comes back, we are going to kill all of you. You are the opposition children. Lot of comments about us.
Did you understand who was being referred to as Oga?
Yeah, Ajame, of course.
At the time, do you know if he was in the country or not?
He was not.
So, from what you told us, there was a soldier called Dauda Koli.
Mm-hmm.
What role, if any, did he play?
I didn't see him play any role apart from just standing outside the hall, looking at what was going on in the hall.
Apart from him, did you recognize any other soldier?
I did not. The only one I recognized was the one insulting us the day I was arrested. That was Solo Bojang. He still lives in Prikama Nyambai.
So prior to that day, you knew Solo Bojang. Is that correct?
Prior to that, exactly.
So you were able to identify him on that day?
Sure.
Do you by any chance know his rank?
I think he was rankless at that time.
And from what you said, he lived in Brikama and continues to live in Brikama.
I believe so, yes.
What else happened at Yundum Barracks, apart from...
Until on Friday, on the 14th of March, later in the day, by midday, I was called out. I was taken to the main gate by the Red Barracks. So they brought in...
Who are the Red Berets?
Those are the soldiers. Just if you enter the Yundum Barracks, I am military police. I was made to understand they are called military police.
Please continue. Yep.
So, they brought a pickup. They asked me to go inside, and they brought another two trucks. They brought the two trucks. All the others, I think most of the detainees in the hall were also brought in and put into those trucks. And then I was put in the pickup, sandwiched by two military police officers, one in front and another, I think two or one at the back.
Just to clarify something, prior to leaving Yundum Barracks, were you tortured at any point, apart from what happened when you were arrested?
No, apart from the time of my arrest, I was never tortured until my release.
Okay.
To be quite honest.
So tell us... Sorry, yes. Please tell us where the military police took you.
They took me to police headquarters. This was on a Friday. I could still remember Yom al-Ashura. It falls on the Yom al-Ashura day. We left Yundum Barracks. We arrived at the police headquarters, I think, by around after 2. And upon arrival, I believe my arrival must have been communicated, because the lady police officer I found, I was taken straight to their communication room upstairs. The police officer I found at the communication room, once I arrived, I believe, like I said, she must have been told about my coming. She was very much sympathetic when she saw me. And then quickly, she asked whether I had been communicating with my family. I said no. He said, come, come, come. Then I went inside another room next to the communication room, and then he handed over a telephone to me to call my family. And then I quickly did that. I started talking to my family members, and then all of a sudden, when he had somebody come in, then we stopped.
Was that the first time that your family members knew what had happened to you?
No, that was not the first time, because before I left Yundum, they came to visit me.
Okay.
Yes.
And you were at Yundum from the 10th of April?
Yes.
Which was a Monday, from what you've said?
Yes.
Until Friday?
Yes.
So for about 4 days?
Yes.
Tell us about what happened after that lady allowed you to call your family, the police officer.
After that, they had lunch. After that, they had lunch. I saw almost all the security heads at the police headquarters within the police. The IGP, Deputy IGP, Ablai Sanyam, PRO at the time, Commissioner of Admin, Babukar Sow at the time, because he was also a neighbor, I know him. They were all there. And they gave me a good lunch, because that was, for the first time, I had a very good meal. Domoda with meat, that was what was given to me. So after that, I was asked to join them in their conference room. A round conference, a squared one. I was put in the middle on camera and recorded with all the security heads. And they started their interview, one after the other.
Can you tell us the names of the security heads that were present, either their names or their positions? Who were they?
I know the IGP was there. The Deputy IGP was also there. Tatinbaji was there. Babukar Sow was there, then Commissioner of Operations, Admin, I believe, because he was in Nebo, so I know him. He was there.
Anyone else that you recognize?
Ablai Sanyang, PRO, police PRO, I believe, was also there. And other police commissioners, whom I could not know their names.
What kind of questions were you asked during the interview?
In relation to how everything started up to what I know about the whole incident, I think it lasted for almost about 2.5 hours.
And what happened to you after that interview?
After that, I was handed over to Tijan Ba, an NIA officer who escorted me to the NIA headquarters that Friday evening, where I was detained for another 6-7 days.
Did anything happen to you at the NIA headquarters?
No, not actually. No physical torture, actually. I was being escorted by Tijan Ba, an NIA officer, and right when you enter the NIA building or premises, the building you will see, there is a house or there is a corridor as well, just like the other one. There are two cells. In the first cell, I found a Sierra Leonean there. In the second cell, I found Nakulan Sise, our advisor, the student union, sub-union advisor. Nakulan Sise was there. And I also found Pa Alasan Sise, the treasurer of Gamsu.
Were you taken to the NIA premises on your own, or were you in a group of detainees?
I was the one taken alone.
How long, you said you spent about 6 or 7 days at the NIA?
Yes, around that.
After that, were you released, or did something else happen to
you? No, I was transferred back to police headquarters to join another three student leaders, Aliou Khan, Sinabu Gay, Babukar An. I found them at the police headquarters. We spent almost about 2-3 days there again.
In total, how much time did you spend in detention?
I think almost about 16 days.
Were you charged at any point?
And I could not remember. We were by a team of lawyers led by Usman Silla. They did a lot for us, and other Gambian lawyers, Bar Association, and including Aliou Dabo, the then president, Student Union, University of the Gambia, did a lot in making sure that we are being released, and other people within and outside the Gambia.
So after about 16 days, you were eventually released.
And I want to put these two things, because they are of importance. At the NIA headquarters, these two people, including myself, three, were the Fritonia. His story is so sad. I believe his name is, if I am not forgotten, Stephen. He has been crying and he has been praying all throughout. A very faithful Christian I have ever seen. He said to me, I ran away from a civil war in my country, only to come to the Gambia to be arrested. I don't know exactly where I am, and I think I spent almost about only few days in the country, and then it coincided with this demonstration, and he was arrested. So he spent some time there, and he was very keen. I could remember every early morning, by 5 a.m. he would start prayers, and he would call us to get up and pray along with him. And there was this morning, he said, today they're going to release me, and it happened. We prayed together, and when early morning they came, he was released. And Buba Samura,
So just to be clear, the Sierra Leonean that you mentioned was not connected in any way with the demonstrations, but was arrested in connection with the demonstrations.
Yes.
Please continue.
And I also found Buba Samura there, the National Assembly member for Kiang East at the time. I met him because I was taken there on Friday, because at NI headquarters we are only given one meal, that is lunch, by 2 o'clock, and it's Benachin every day. So, it's a small basin. Five of us will share the Benachin. And he will be brought out from his cell to join us to have lunch, Buba Samura. So when he met me that Saturday while at lunch, he was pale, exhausted, and he started asking me, he said, Nding, where are you from? I told him, I said, I'm from Brikama. He said, who is your father? And I told him about my father. I said, my father is Keba Jubi. He said, I know your father. And then he started bursting into tears. He said he's been kept in a dark cell where he could not see anything. And they will get into the cell during nighttime and will be beaten.
Did he tell you why he was arrested?
He said it was in connection to the demonstration because the conclusion at the NIA headquarters, at 3 occasions we have been called to give our statements. For me, when they took me to give out my statement, it will take me 2-3 hours. So Hydra in particular will complain. I said, you cannot complain because what I know is what I'm going to write. I cannot shorten my story because I have a story to tell. And at the end, what they concluded was, we are all opposition children. That was what they concluded. The opposition were behind us.
What's the name of this Hydra that you mentioned?
I can't remember the first name, but I know he's either a fine complexion guy.
In your statement, it states Sheikh Tijan Hydra. Uh-huh. Is that correct?
Then it must be the one.
After you were released, and I need to wrap this up because we have run out of time. After you were released, did you come across any other post-mortem report regarding what happened to Ibrahima Barry?
I understood there was one that they did. I believe it was exhumed and another post-mortem. I understood that was narration, that because they said they were not satisfied with this first one, because then at the time they said Dr. Sam was the pathologist and was not in the country, and then the Cuban, Dr. Rafael Rizzo did the post-mortem. So they did another one, I made to understand.
And where did you understand that?
From narration, I think from even papers, from newspapers, if I'm not forgotten, yes.
And from the narration that you heard, what was different about the new post-mortem report from what you understood?
The only difference will be this one perhaps will contain something favorable to the authorities.
That's what you understood from what you heard?
Yes.
But you did not actually see the report?
Exactly. That's my understanding.
Finally, in your post as information minister within the sub-union, did you come across the names of individuals that were actually killed during the demonstrations of April 10 and 11?
Yes, from newspapers that I have gathered, I have the names of those who were killed.
Can you tell us those names?
Usman Sabali is one of them, from Brikama Ba, was only 15 years old. Omar Barrow, a Red Cross volunteer, Mohamed Lamine Jai from Fonyi, a GTTI student, Kalisco Prera, Mohamed Lamine Chun, Latikunda, junior secondary school at the time, Regina Carol, Karamu Barrow, Ice, senior secondary school at the time, Lamine A. Bojang, Nusra senior secondary school, Bamba Jobate, Abdullahi Sanyang, a 3-year-old from Joswang, Burama Baji, 10-year-old Talinding, Wee Mansali Talinding, Islamic Institute. And the 13th one, I believe, was the young man I spoke about that was shot at Brikama, because I believe I was made to understand up to the time of burial, they could not identify the body. And later, reading through the Foreign newspaper, I came across another name, that is Seni Nyabali, which took place at Brikamaba.
And in fact, you have provided a stack of newspapers to the commission's investigators, and we will go through that information, which we received recently. From what you found out, how did the 3-year-old die?
From the newspaper, I think it is through stampede. The 3-year-old died as a result of stampede.
The last question from me is, considering everything that happened, everything that you witnessed, what happened to you as well, what impact did this, the events of April 10 and 11 have on you?
On me, in particular.
On you in particular, as well as other students that you know?
On me, I think, except the positive aspect, because I have prepared for this from day one. I read a lot of good things about good people all over the world, equally as about dictators, about very terrible dictators for that matter. Kamusu Banda is one such. So, going through, because that, in fact, that was what I went with when I found Alassane Pa-Alassane crying all throughout. I told him, you better remember Nelson Mandela as an icon. That's the only way out. We are in seat already, because anything could happen. So we have to obviously know that things are serious. A lot of lives, property has already been damaged. So that impact on me, I would say, I learned a lot. Was a learning point for me. But on the part of the union or unionism, it has paralyzed unionism in the country, particularly Gamsu, because we saw an emergency of a fake union or student body called NAPSA that represented the affairs of the students of this country.
When you say fake, what do you mean by that? Who initiated that group? NAPSA.
When in actual fact people are called students association, when some of them are not students, they've already finished school. You're putting them together, you call them students.
Do you know who controlled that group?
Yeah, Jamie, of course.
Did he control the group through any individual in particular? Did he control the group through a particular individual at the time?
I guess so.
Who was that?
I think Sidi Jai was one of them, because later he was nominated to be part of the National Assembly, so that also speaks volumes.
Mr. Chairman, I probably shouldn't have said that was my last question, but I will ask another question just now. After the events of April 10 and 11, did you or members of the union have a meeting with then-President Yahya Jammeh?
Yeah, after the Latte Commission, when we were being summoned to the Latte Commission for the public disturbances of the April 10 and 11, the report, according to when he received it, invited us as a group, and we went there. He spoke about a lot of things, that he will do everything possible to make sure that no stone is left unturned to make sure justice has been served. And at the end of the day, that was the end of the story.
Was anything done as a result of?
I could not remember.
Are you aware of any measures that were taken?
I'm not.
Mr. Job, thank you very much for your testimony and for appearing before the Commission on such short notice. Mr. Chairman, I have concluded. I hand over to the Commissioners for additional questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chairman Council, and thank you very much, Chairman Mr. Job, for your testimony. Before I turn to the Commissioners, if they have any questions to pose, just a small anecdote. It never occurred to me that 19 years after what we heard in Havana, Cuba, we struggled the morning of the 10th and 11th of April. I was in Havana with the Secretary General of the United Nations, Kofi Annan, and the Secretary General is briefed every morning by his press secretary, and we get briefing from the Department of Political Affairs on developments around the world. When the briefing note summary came, we looked at it, and there were two references to developments in the Gambia. And of course, he just turned to me and said, Lamine, you don't have troubles in your country, but it seems as if these things are getting to be a bit serious. He wanted to know quickly what the developments were here. I mean, the violence that was going on, the killing of the students, because if we had detailed information, we were planning on having a meeting with the Gambian delegation that President Jammeh was heading. He was only a few meters away from us, the UN delegation where we were seated, and we didn't get that. That information didn't come, the detailed information didn't come. And as I said, this is a twist in life that 19 years later, here I am sitting here, hearing those details that perhaps would have made it possible for the Secretary General of the United Nations to meet with Jammeh to try to make sure that things don't get out of hand in the Gambia, notwithstanding the slaughter of young students in the area. Just a small anecdote, but he was there with them, his own delegation, Jammeh, and in that big hall, Annan turned to me at some point and said, he would say, your friend. He said, your friend has got this big telephone sitting right on his desk in the big hall in the area. He was communicating with the Gambia, with what was going on here, and monitoring that. But anyway, thank you so much, Jammeh. As I said, it was a 19-year wait for me to hear exactly what really happened. He was very much concerned about Gambia. He loved Gambia. He loved Gambians. Ironically, yesterday was the first anniversary of his passing away, Kofi Annan. And to hear a day later the details just got me a bit moved. But Commissioners, if you have any questions, Commissioner Jones, have the floor, please.
Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Job, I have one follow-on question regarding the widespread allegations that Mr. Ibrahima was fed cement. You said your investigations revealed that this was not the case, right? Do you know what gave birth to the allegations, the widespread allegations, that that was in fact the case with him?
I believe it must have been sparked by, because others have it that he was asked to carry bags of cement. But the point of eating cement obviously was denied by the father vehemently, and even Alaji, Gianna, do not say anything about that, because they said Ibrahima didn't tell them anything about that. What he told them and what he emphasized, particularly to Alaji, was he was mercilessly being beaten. He confirmed that. Water poured on him repeatedly. He was asked to monkey dance, and his hair saved off.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Carr.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Job. Part of our mandate includes investigating institutional failures that led to some of these human rights violations and abuses. So pardon me if I ask a question that has been asked already. But my first question is, since you've been in the education sector for long, I want to know whether there is anything regarding disciplinary policy within the sector.
I believe there are policies around discipline or disciplinary issues within the school system that I know. But at the level of the ministry, I can't say for certain. But I know at the level of the schools, we do have policies.
Thank you. So then that brings me to the second question, which is, would you say that the taking Mr. Barry, the late Mr. Barry to the fire service, would you say that conforms to those disciplinary policies within the school system?
Yeah, that was what obviously when everything started with that, everything went against that policy. And that was why when we realized it, our force thing we thought of was to talk to the students about matters of discipline and to even urge the school administration not to ever involve a third party in the discipline or in the disciplinary aspect of students, because the end result is always going to be a problematic or negative effect.
Thank you. My final question is, do you know if the then ministry, the leadership of the then ministry, did anything to investigate the incident?
Well, I think the then ministry were hypocritical. They were hypocrites. Episode of Ibrahim Abari. So many things that they did, because after the press release of the then president, you saw the teachers' union, the conference of principals, you saw parents coming together to ban students from being part of GAMSU. So you could see the hypocrisy in what the Department of State of Education did at that time. In fact,